Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness.
Lord, we need you. My brothers and sisters in the Lord, welcome to Say Yes to Life, where we learn to embrace our Catholic faith in the secular world. I'm your host, Peter Ainge, Chief Executive Officer of Ohio Right to Life, and welcome to show number 361 as we continue the fight for the dignity and value of every single human life, born, pre-born, and yours in our world today. In today's show, we are blessed to welcome Dr. Alicia Thompson, who is a board-certified OBGYN in private practice in Westerville, Ohio. Dr. Thompson, with her husband, Dr. Greg Thompson, have five children, ages 4 to 13, and are expecting their sixth child. Dr. Thompson credits her experience as a physician as a primary factor in converting to Christianity in 2007, and she ultimately entered the Catholic Church in 2009. We'll talk a little bit about that on the show today, but Dr. Thompson wrote that in confronting the dignity of human life in the womb, she encountered God. And it was through that encounter with God that she experienced her truest call as a disciple of Jesus Christ. It took a few years before she fully surrendered her vocation as a physician to God's purposes and aligned her practice with her faith. But in doing so, she learned about NAPRO technology, FEM methods to treat reproductive health issues. She volunteers at her local pregnancy center at her parish and serves, oh, by the way, on the board of Ohio Right to Life. So basically, folks, she's my boss. And if I don't do this interview well, I could be in trouble. No, I'm just kidding. But in all seriousness, it's going to be a great show. But first, let's go ahead and take 180 seconds around the state and the nation to talk about what's happening in the pro-life movement and the news. First, folks, we got to address it because it's a topic of marriage, of sexuality and life, which is all related. And it comes up often on this show quite a bit because we talk about human sexuality. And this is just, it's making headline news. So just 2 days ago, the Congregation of the Doctrine of Faith, with the approval of Pope Francis, stated that same-sex couples could receive a blessing from a priest. The new document reaffirms that marriage is a lifelong union between a man and a woman. I'm going to take a minute or two here, so just bear with me. But it stresses that blessings and questions must not be tied to any specific Catholic celebration or religious service, should not be conferred at the same time as a civil union ceremony. And moreover, these blessings cannot use set rituals or even involve the clothing and gestures that belong in a wedding. But it says that a request for such blessing for same-sex couples should not be denied. It offers an extensive and broad definition of the term blessing in Scripture to insist that people seeking a transcendent relationship with God and looking for His love and mercy shouldn't be held up to an impossible moral standard to receive it. Now look, while I agree that every individual person who's seeking to live a chaste life or is seeking to be a follower of Christ should never be denied a blessing, the issue at hand here is the new teaching that couples living a life not in accord with church teaching can be blessed. You know, would we bless, for example, a couple living in an extramarital union or relationship? I don't think so, but this document would seem to open the possibility to a myriad of different blessings, which again goes to couples that are not living in accord with church teaching. I think this presents major problems for the church. Bishop Athanasius Schneider, perhaps the harshest tone against the document in a letter posted on social media, said that, quote, "The fact that the document does not give permission for the marriage of same-sex couples should not blind pastors and faithful to the great deception and the evil that resides in the very permission to bless couples in irregular situations in same-sex couples," wrote Schneider. He finished, "Such a blessing directly and seriously contradicts divine revelation and the uninterrupted by millennial doctrine and practice of the Catholic Church." The Conference of Roman Catholic Bishops of Ukraine stated that it understood the document to be aligned with the Church's understanding of marriage, but feared confusion and misunderstandings. The Ukrainian bishops wrote that, quote, "While the entire document makes it clear that there is no permission or blessing for the homosexual cohabitation or any life of sin, nor any change in the Church's traditional teaching on marriage, the notion of blessing same-sex couples or even sacramentally irregular couples can be perceived as legalizing these relationships," end quote. So here I think is maybe one of the largest problems with the document. It leads these blessings to be open to interpretation when just 2 years ago, before Pope Francis appointed a new leader of the CDF, the Church said you could not bless same-sex couples just 2 years ago. But now we already have some celebrity priests already posting pictures of publicly blessing same-sex couples. So it further confuses the faithful at a time when we need moral clarity. And when, quite frankly, even this week, we should be focused on the incarnation of Christ, not debating the blessing of same-sex couples as a church. So the timing of the announcement the replacing of the former leader of the CDF who disagreed with this, and then ultimately the disunion of this teaching with the faith raises serious alarms that I hope bishops from around the world will help with. And look, I risk the the possibility of me being more Catholic than the Pope in this situation, but I digress. More to come on this story. And until then, please pray for the Holy Father, pray for the situation, pray for the Church. All right, second, a newly released document or report by the Dimitri Institute for Pro-Life Advancement investigated all 767 colleges and universities affiliated with Christian churches in the United States throughout 2023. According to their findings, 76 or 1 in 10 Christian schools maintain some type of relationship with Planned Parenthood and the abortion industry. Now, considering that Planned Parenthood sells the most abortions compared with any other vendor and has proven to set up shop in college towns, 87% of its locations are within 5 miles or less of a college campus, it comes at no shock that the abortion giant has also crept its way onto faith-based schools. Now, what is alarming also is, according to these new findings, the number of Christian schools supporting Planned Parenthood or the abortion industry directly has increased by 10% since 2021. Now, this seems like a no-brainer here to me. If you run a Christian college, Planned Parenthood shouldn't be anywhere on it. All right, third and finally, I just want to ask you, will you join me in 2024? Will you join me in re-engaging in the pro-life movement? Either take an hour a week to pray at your local abortion facility, donate monthly to Ohio Right to Life or your favorite pro-life charity, volunteer at your local pregnancy center, recommit to praying daily for the end to abortion, or going out and canvassing for pro-life candidates. Whatever it is, just say yes. Give your fiat. To rebuild the culture of life, it begins with you. So join me in 2024 to fight for the dignity and value of every single human life. One of those individuals who fights for the dignity and value of every single human life is Dr. Alicia Thompson. Joining me today, she's a mother, she's a doctor, she's on the board of Ohio Right to Life. She does it all. Dr. Alicia, thank you so much for joining me today on CS to Life. And maybe we can just begin with your story. And we'll get to a conversation in the next question a little bit about your conversion to the faith. I think that's going to be really interesting. But why don't we just start where you grew up and how you met your husband and what ultimately drew you to the work of medicine?
Yeah, thank you, Peter, so much. It's an honor to speak with you and to be on your show today. Thank you. So I say I kind of grew up in Florida, but my father was on active duty in the Air Force in a fighter squadron. So we moved a lot, and I spent less than half my childhood in Florida, but that's where my extended family was from, so I kind of claim that as home. I went there to college and medical school, and then ultimately received an Air Force scholarship to pay for medical school, and was assigned to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base on active duty. And I came here on active duty in 2006, met my husband, got married, and realized that I was going to be a Midwesterner for the long haul.
Was it love at first sight with your husband, or did he have to win you over a little bit?
He says on his end it was love at first sight. I would not say the same in my direction, but I liked him, you know. He was a very bright, attractive person, but I didn't have like the electric sparks that he would say that he had when he met me.
Sure.
But I'll take that. That was, I'd love to hear it. But we had a very quick courtship. I mean, we were engaged at a year and married at like a year and a half of us dating.
Mm. Awesome. Very cool. And what was it that attracted you to medicine? I mean, why did you want to become a doctor?
Well, I am kind of just a decision maker, and then I stick to it. I don't really waffle a lot. I'm not much of a fickle person in that way. So when I was a child, somebody once asked me, what do you think you're going to be when you grow up? And I said, I think maybe a doctor. And it just, I don't know what happened when I was a child, but it resonated with me. I was always kind of academic and bookish, and I had a call toward working with other people, and I really was interested in science, so it kind of brought all those things together. I was open to other ideas, but I never kind of really veered from that direction, and I stuck with it the whole ride.
That's awesome. Well, tell us a little bit about your journey to convert to Christianity and then ultimately to Catholicism. What kind of sparked that, and share some of those, you know, major highlights in your journey?
Sure. I think, you know, go back when I was a child, I didn't really have faith in the home. One of the problems of my father growing up in the military is that you don't get a consistent external culture outside of your home life because of the military culture is a constant shuffling of the deck. People come in and out of bases, come in and out of your classroom. So I never really had a mentor in a coach or in a family friend. We all moved around. So while faith was not in my home in any way, really at all growing up, we didn't pray. We didn't read the Bible. We didn't go to church. I really didn't know anything about faith at all until I kind of got into high school. And then my experience with it was kind of, if I'm direct, kind of negative. Then when I went off to college, I did all the things where I was like stolen away by the world and was very secular, did all the things secular culture would tell you to do. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until I came to Dayton and I realized I just kind of was in a personal crisis and I didn't know what was happening. I didn't understand what was going on. And sadly, it revolved around a breakup. I had been involved with somebody for several years, over 4 years, and his parents are Polish immigrants. And they went to Mass. And so when we would go visit his parents, they would take us to Mass. That was just a requirement of going to their home and visiting with them. Mm. And sometimes they would take us to Mass, and it was in Polish, and I had no idea what was going on, completely vague to me. Mm-hmm. But then when I ended up having this crisis in medical or in residency, I didn't know where to go. I started asking these really big questions, the big questions of like, what's the meaning of life? Mm-hmm. Why are we here? How can I have checked all the boxes that society would say are important and I can still be so deeply unhappy? Mm-hmm. And what's, you know, what is wrong? How I could have built this life and feel so unfulfilled. And so in that searching and that seeking, you know, I turned to religion, which so many other people do. It's like, those are the questions that you ask, those big questions. And I had gone to denominational churches. Mm-hmm. And I ultimately had my conversion experience in a non-denominational church. Mm-hmm. But it was kind of difficult in my schedule to work that out. I couldn't be at this one church, at this one place, at this one time for several months. I felt very disconnected. And when I was like, wow, where else can I go except for this one church? I remembered my ex-boyfriend's parents and how they drew so much strength and had such a beautiful marriage. And they were Catholic. So I went into a Catholic church, and that's like how I darkened the door as an individual seeking. And I kind of, that was, I think, gosh, in 2008, I think, and I never really looked back.
Mm. So help me with the timeline a little bit as far as, you know, did Greg play any part in this, or was that kind of separate from your journey with your husband?
Oh, totally. Well, it was kind of separate in the sense that, so to be very direct, like what helped me with my conversion, why my medical career was so significant, mm-hmm. is I was struggling with the question of my own dignity. You know, why was I so depressed? Why was this happening to me? Mm-hmm. And around that same time, I was taking care of women in gynecology, and they would have unplanned pregnancies or pregnancies, and I would take care of women. I can remember distinctly going into some rooms or a room, and a woman would be early in her pregnancy, and it was obvious she was overjoyed. You know, she had a partner with her, sometimes parents, and they were so excited. And they would say, let's see the baby. Can we see the baby? Do you see the heartbeat? And, you know, I would do very humanizing language. I would turn the ultrasound screen to them. I would show them. I would point out the baby and all these things. And then I could go into another room. And, you know, most of us are pretty good at reading a room. And I would go into another room, and this woman may be alone. She may be, you know, with someone. Everyone looks dark and dreary. And I could pick up very quickly that this woman also was pregnant, but was very undesired. And in those rooms, I would turn the screen away. I would use dehumanizing language, like your pregnancy is this far along. I would never use the word baby. I would never point out heartbeats. I would dehumanize. Mm. And I struggled so much with the way my behavior was changing based on the perception of what I, you know, was receiving on the desiredness or wantedness of these pregnancies. Mm-hmm. And there's these four basic medical principles of healthcare, which is, you know, justice, autonomy, beneficence, and non-maleficence. And we hear about autonomy all the time in women's health. Mm-hmm. But I found this to be a lack of justice, that the way I would view these human beings was changing based on what people felt about them. And I really struggled with this crisis of, what was I actually going to train an abortion like I had planned to do? And I ultimately found I couldn't do that. Mm. And I didn't understand why I couldn't. I didn't know what was pulling me away from what I had planned to do. I didn't have words, you know, I didn't have the Catholic lingo or the Christian lingo to understand what was happening. It was an attack of my conscience, honestly. And I didn't know what that was. So I was trying to grapple with all of that. And so when I, that's when I went seeking, like, where's this voice coming from? What's happening? And I became Christian. And then a great, I love this story so much, but I would ask anyone. I was on fire for Jesus. I was like, what is going on? Somebody talk to me. What's the difference between Methodists, Baptists, Episcopalians, Lutherans? Like, what are the differences? And no one knew. I think it made everyone awkward, honestly, Peter. No one wanted to talk to me. And one day, a couple weeks later, after one of the doctors in the operating room heard me talking about this stuff, she brought me the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And she gave it the worst sell. She handed me the Catechism, and she said, I'm a lapsed Catholic, so I have no use for this, but you may find it helpful because this is what Catholics believe and why. And right in front of her, I flipped it open to the back and I looked up the word conscience because I wanted to know what that voice was. And it's Article 1776. And I read it and I thought, this is it. This is the voice of God echoing in my life, calling me on to greater things and to call me out as his beloved. And I knew that I was going to be Catholic. And I didn't know any Catholics. So then when my husband came into my service, he saw me one day. I was RCIA shopping. I didn't know that you had to become a member of a parish and go through RCIA. I was literally calling around, like, what does your program look like? I want to know. What's your RCIA program like? And he saw me looking at it over his shoulder. And he said, oh, are you becoming Catholic? And I was like, yes, I am. And I didn't know any. And he's like, I'm a Catholic. So I just kind of berated him with questions. I wanted to know all the things. And so he and I began a friendship because I would go to him and ask questions. And his parents, you know, so beautifully say that I helped bring him back into the faith because he wanted to answer these questions. And he was interested in me, you know, his love at first sight. He was like, I want to impress this girl. So he started reading more and seeking more in order to answer my questions. And that's how our relationship unfolded.
Wow. So, you know, you're going through this period of time in your life. There's, it sounds like there's sin in the background. There's some maybe doubting of self-worth. And then you're also working with patients, moms, some who are excited to have life, some who are not. But really the voice of conscience and struggling with all these things kind of force you to reckon with the value of your own life, the value of others' lives, and asking those big questions. You know, what am I doing here? And what's the ultimate purpose for all of this? And then someone who's a lapsed Catholic hands you the Catechism and says, well, this might be helpful. It's incredible the way that the Lord kind of works in the midst of everyone's story to kind of draw him close. And I think the opening paragraph to the Catechism, if our listeners have never just sat down and opened the Catechism, is one of the most beautiful passages there is, I feel like, almost in the church. That in every time and every place, God is drawing close to you. And certainly we're experiencing that this Christmas as we reflect upon the infant Christ coming to us. And so I want to just maybe take a little bit of time here in the show, and we'll get into women's health because I think that's very important for our listeners to hear about. But before I do, because it is that special time of year, we're celebrating a birth, and not just any birth, the coming of Jesus Christ. And right now you're pregnant as well, and you've given birth five times. Has there been anything on your heart and mind during this Advent season, this time of preparation, or as we move into Christmas, as we enter into these holy days, gazing on the miracle of Jesus's birth? What's been on your heart and mind praying through these days?
Oh, truly the heroic work of motherhood, the incredible gift that we have to be life bearers, and the incredible vulnerability that is created within us to do that, and the incredible gift of authentic marriages to be surrounded by a loving community, and particularly in support of my husband, who upholds me in this work, this great work of mothering. And what a privilege it is to be a woman. What a privilege it is that God came from a woman and just endowed motherhood with such a beautiful blessing as to the incarnate of a woman. And that is just heavily on my heart right now as I'm becoming more heavily pregnant, and what a privilege it is to be so.
Yeah. Thank you for that. It's, it's all inspiring. The feminine genius of carrying life within you. I mean, what a tremendous, powerful, amazing, amazing gift that we have to lift back up in our culture and society and share just how special and how unique and how beautiful it is. No one but a woman can carry life within her. So what a tremendous, tremendous gift. So let's talk a little bit about women's health then. A large part of your practice as a board certified OBGYN, you are caring for women that are struggling with infertility, other health issues. And so you've dived into NAPRO technology and FEM methods. It's really a more holistic approach. I wonder if we could just kind of define those things for some folks who are listening today. What is NAPRO technology? What is FEM when we're talking about women's health? And can you then kind of just talk to us about what is real, authentic women's health care? Because, you know, we hear this counterfeit idea out there in media today that, you know, abortion is health care, or, you know, here, the contraception pill, that's our solution to everything. You got acne, you can take it. You got pain, you know, here, take the pill. But it's really just masking symptoms. So talk to us a little bit more about authentic women's health care. And maybe if you could define terms for us, what is NAPRO technology? What is FEM methods?
Sure. So generally, I would say that authentic women's health care is extraordinarily broad, and it can look like so many different things for other women. But what you offer, as I say in my practice, what you put on the menu is what you think is effective and important for women. And so I was trained, like every other bread and butter OBGYN, never to learn a natural family planning method. I never was taught ever. I never received a single lecture on what a natural planning chart would look like, how you would, generally treat gynecologic health issues or identify them even using basic charting. So when I became a Catholic, it took me a couple years to be able to have the confidence, quite frankly, to align my practice with my faith. It took literally 3 years about for me to be able to do that. And part of it was just, to be direct, ignorance. I just was ignorant of different methods of treating disease that hadn't been taught to me. Doctors can be notorious know-it-alls. If we don't know something, we just think possibly, you know, maybe it's not worth knowing. And so when I became an authentic Catholic and people started seeing me and they'd say, oh, you're Catholic, you know, I go to Mass, you go to Mass, can you help me with this? And I didn't know what it was. So honestly, my patients drew this out of me. They wanted to know, and my community and culture wanted to, you know. So I'm like, what are these women talking about? So I started looking up NAPRO technology and FEM, and there are other methods as well. Mm-hmm. But generally, overview, there's fertility awareness-based methods of family planning, meaning how you can plan for or delay pregnancy using natural holistic means. Mm-hmm. And then also how you can discover underlying gynecologic health issues based on what you're seeing in a woman's fertility, in terms of her menstrual cycles, her bleeding, pain that she's having, hormonal issues she may be experiencing at different times of her cycle. So both the FEM method and the Creighton model are two specific ones I'll give you as an example, are a natural family planning method, or the Creighton model likes to say it's a fertility appreciation-based method. So these methods basically teach women how to do menstrual charting to achieve or to delay or avoid pregnancy. But in that charting, you're able to pick up abnormalities in the chart that can help you identify gynecologic health problems, or can better help you understand what the woman herself has already identified. And then typically what you try to do, at least for my patients, is, you know, you could get an endless list of OBGYNs who are willing to just hand out the pill or to give you the depot shot or to give, you know, whatever it happens to be, an IUD. It's the woman who's trying to walk the faith of saying, you know, I value fertility. I do not want to just immediately go to something that shuts the whole system off. Where do I go? Mm-hmm. Well, those are the types of women that I feel God has called me and equipped me to serve, those women that are looking for avenues that uphold fertility as a good. And so I try to maintain fertility, restore fertility in those cases.
Do you feel like any of these methods are gaining any steam or interest in mainstream medicine, or are they still kind of just pushed to the side, like your experience? Like, you didn't even learn any NFP methods through your time in medical school.
Oh, you know, I think it's actually significantly gaining steam. Years ago, there were just a few. But praise God, one of the amazing parts of technology is that you can have fertility apps. You know, watches have them. women can get all sorts of thermometers. So there's a lot of technology that has been developed that help women to use these methods in a much more accurate and scientific way. As soon as a person says something like, oh, it's the rhythm method, you know, like the rhythm method was actually a book, I think it was published in 1929 and had very specific parameters. I don't know a single person who's ever used directly themselves the official rhythm method. So I think that it's kind of generally disparaged. Mm-hmm. But as women take power and control, I should say, of their own healthcare, they are coming to us with it more often, which I'm really grateful to see. They want to do their charting. They have their bleeding patterns on their phone. Some of them have their basal body temperatures. And then you can do very basic things like go onto Amazon and order more advanced fertility testing like LH test strips. Some women check their urinary metabolites of estradiol, like some really advanced stuff that's available, quite frankly, over the counter. And that push from the patients pushes the doctors to learn more and to offer more in their practices.
You know, there seems to be a real opportunity, especially as people care more about the environment and just making sure healthy things are put in their body or unhealthy things are not put in their body, that we have an opportunity really to speak to women about maybe some of these more natural methods to work with their fertility rather than against it when it comes to, you know, planning future families. And unfortunately, we only got about 30 seconds left to go on the show. So I wish we had another half hour to talk to you, Alicia. But just your thoughts, final thoughts, any bullet points on restoring a culture of life, you know, returning to appreciating and valuing innocent human life. And then where do we begin to do that?
Well, I think the ultimate answer to that always is to go back to the creator of life. I think that as we become unmoored from our foundations of Judeo-Christian values, that we go away from that author of life. If you want to understand your own dignity and the dignity of the human beings around you, you have to understand it fundamentally as a person created in the image and likeness of God.
That's a terrific way to end the show. Dr. Alicia Thompson, thank you so much for taking time. I hope as a board member of Ohio Right to Life, I did an okay job interviewing you so I can keep my job. But again, appreciate you taking time and thank you for the great work you do for the pro-life movement. Continue the great fight and have a wonderful Christmas.
Thank you, Peter. Merry Christmas. Happy Advent.
All right. Merry Christmas. God bless everybody. Enjoy kneeling at the crib this Christmas. God bless you.